window, the Q&A window, so we'll get to it. So with that, I wanted to welcome John Irwin. How are you doing today?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing great. So why don't you take it away?
For sure. Thanks for the opportunity here, Craig. Great to work with you. As Craig said, my name is John Irwin. I am a government funding, I would consider myself an expert after 12 years of doing this. Primarily the focus today is going to be, we're going to talk to you a little about Leyton, because Leyton is relatively new in Canada, but we are a global company. So we're trying to really get our name out there because we are really good at what we do. And we love what we do. So talk to you a little bit about Leyton, give you kind of a, and I'm sure Craig has gone over this many, many times with in other presentations, but what types of different funds are there out to grow, just to kind of set the landscape for this. Give you an idea of the difference between a tax credit and a grant, because there is a huge difference. I'm going to talk a little bit about SR&ED. I know most of you probably know of or are already claiming SR&ED. But for those of you that don't, I'd like to give some details about that. Talk to you about some grant strategies when it comes to applying for grants, because there are some good strategies that you can use and implement. And then give you guys some real grant examples that you can take away and look at yourself. We will be providing this presentation as a PDF to Craig after, and he can share it with all the panelists as well. And then, as a last, always a little bit of sales at the end, how we can help you with that if you want our help. Some people do like to do it on their own, and all the more power to them. Some people like to have some support. And so we can talk about that and kind of how we go from there. So we'll jump right into it. Again, as Craig said, if there's any questions, please write them in the Q&A section or the chat window, and we'll get to them after. I like to get to them at the end, because then we have a nice flow to the presentation. So just so you don't forget, just write them out and we'll talk. And we'll address them at the end. So Leyton is, we're based in France. We're founded in 97. Our bread and butter is SR&ED and government grants. We also do sales tax recovery and property tax assessments. Worldwide, we have over 20,000 clients. We have 31 different offices. We're in 12 different countries. Each of those countries that we're in has an established R&D tax credit. So we're in where the tax credit is part of the legislation. So in the US, we just opened recently, because in the Obama era, he finally implemented the R&D tax credit as part of the legislation. So it's a recurring tax credit now. Before, it was year to year. We have over 20 plus years experience, over 1500 employees. And one thing that we're proud of is that 40% of those are female. So we're very diverse in the employees that we have. In Canada specifically, we've got two offices. We are looking to expand into a third office out west pre-COVID. So we'll see what happens. Excuse me, we'll see what happens post-COVID. We have over 11 years experience, over 50 employees, and over 700 clients currently. We opened up, so I came from PwC, and I joined Leyton in May of 2019, and we opened up the Toronto office May of 2019 with two people. We're now at I think we're at just under 40 people, or just under 2 years later. So we have some great growth, and I feel like we're doing the right thing. So let's get right into it. Where can funds come from to help you grow your business? There's personal funds, as you guys know, that's high risk. It requires some strict financial discipline. It depends on your personal status, how much you have. There's equity investments, but you have to give up some ownership or share dilution. And there's an increased number of stakeholders involved in your company. Loans can come from banks or mortgages. They can also come from some of these government funding bodies. FedDev is one example of, they provide zero interest repayable loans. There's different options. BDC is a good one for startups as well. And we have some good connections there. The two that we're going to primarily focus on today are tax credits and grants. So as you know, tax credit is, you have no risk of losing equity or raising debt because it's based on eligibility. And it's based on money you've already paid. Grants, there again, no risk of losing equity, but the success is based on timing and eligibility. So those are the two that we're going to focus on today. And I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the difference between the two, because there is a huge difference. So a tax credit is, you're entitled to it. Tax, the, for example, the shred tax credit is, it's part of the Tax Act. So there's this thick Tax Act of Canada. On one paragraph of one page of this thick Tax Act is the shred $3 billion a year federal program. You are entitled to it, but the requirements are pretty strict. They have, it's, I call the shred tax credit more of a compliance program more than an incentive nowadays. But if you meet the requirements, you're guaranteed to get the money. Whereas grants are very competitive. If there's one thing you can take away from thinking about grants is you must be granted permission before spending the money or starting the project or doing the training. So a grant is an upfront money that you get. Typically how it happens is you get approval to spend the money. Then as you spend the money, you get reimbursed. Whereas a tax credit, you file it with your taxes at the end of the year. So you spend the money throughout the fiscal year, and then you get reimbursed for the money that you've spent, whereas grants, you get reimbursed as you go. But the grant landscape nowadays, especially because of COVID, is very, very competitive. One example, there used to be, for agriculture, there's these CAP grants, Canadian Agricultural Partnership. They used to open up three times a year. They weren't overly competitive, and they were open, the intake period was open for the time that they had allocated. But because of COVID, they only opened up once last year. And after 3 days of being open for intake, they closed because there were so many applications. So it's much more competitive now than ever for grants. Quick introduction to the SR&ED program. As I said, it's part of the Tax Act. It is available in every province. So there are different rates for every province. Alberta has eliminated theirs, but they are introducing a new 20% something or other. We don't know the total, what that looks like, but most provinces do have their own part of the SR&ED tax credit. So now SR&ED, just to kind of talk about the difference, SR&ED is a subset of R&D, okay? Just quickly, R&D is where it includes market research, your due diligence, it includes analysis, product development, packaging, consumer testing, and most of that doesn't qualify for SR&ED. SR&ED is a subset of R&D. Your SR&ED project starts when you've done all your due diligence and you've come across a problem that goes where you're uncertain whether or not you can resolve it, and it goes beyond standard practice. So you have to undertake experimental development to expand your capabilities to either produce a new or improved material, product, or process. That's primarily where the SR&ED is focused in. These are the five questions for eligibility. I'm not gonna really go over them in depth. I'm gonna go over the next slide, which is makes it puts it more into layman's terms. But just to let you know, this is kind of the terminology in the CRA language that we like to say. And this is where we can help. With your SR&ED claim is taking the layman's term or the language that you speak and translating it into what the CRA is looking for. So just as an example, the first question, was there a scientific or technological uncertainty? An uncertainty of whether or how the results or objective can be achieved based on the existing knowledge base. Essentially what they're asking there is, what was the problem? What was the problem you were trying to solve where it wasn't available in the public domain, you had to go beyond standard practice and you were uncertain you could resolve the problem. The next question that they're looking for, and they call it a hypothesis, is essentially, what did you try? What did you try to overcome the problem? The third question is, what was the outcome of your attempt? So you must have attempted maybe one or two or three different solutions, because if the first or second didn't work, what was the outcome of those attempts? What did you learn? And then the fourth question kind of goes hand in hand with the third one is, did those attempts succeed or fail? Did you overcome your problem or did you fail? Failures are good indicators of SR&ED. I know they're not good for business, but they are good indicators of potential SR&ED eligibility. And they want to know, what did you learn from your attempts that succeeded or failed? The fifth one is very key when it comes to SR&ED, the compliance, as I like to say, is the documentation. How did you keep track of your work? So that's very key when it comes to claiming SR&ED. I made this slide for Ontario, but if you want to know specific numbers for your province, I can also give them to you. These are after all the calculations are done, taking into account the provincial rates and the federal rates and the proxy overhead proxy amount for overhead. This is what you can expect to get back for every SR&ED eligible dollar. There's four eligible expenses for SR&ED. The first is Canadian salaried employees. In Ontario, you can expect to get back about 65 cents for every SR&ED eligible salary dollar paid. For materials consumed or transformed, you can expect to get back about 42 cents. For Canadian subcontractors that you use for your SR&ED project, you can expect to get back about 35 cents. And for third-party payments, that's a payment that's made to a research organization to get access to their IP that they've developed. There's a bunch of them there's a list that the CRA has. You can get back about 42 cents for that. This is just a slide for reference for you to show you how I came up to those. Essentially, you take your expenditures and you do a bunch of calculations, and this is the end result. That's the end number for Ontario. And if anyone's interested in a specific province, I'm more than happy to walk you through the calculations. But you'll see here for Ontario, there's two SR&ED tax credits. One is called the Ontario Innovation Tax Credit, and one is called the Ontario Research and Development Tax Credit. The ORDTC in Ontario is a non-refundable, which means that it only goes towards taxes owed. Just one thing to note, these numbers that I'm showing you are for Canadian controlled private companies. Okay. So that means 51% of shares are owned by Canadian companies or Canadian entities. If you're a foreign owned company or you're publicly traded, these numbers essentially become half of their worth and become non-refundable, which means it only goes towards taxes owed. So we're in a unique position here at Leyton, and I'm in a unique position. I have a direct line of contact with the head of SR&ED, Jason Chahon, and him and I meet on a quarterly basis. And from that, I'm just going to touch on a few points, but this is a reference for you guys just to kind of showcase our expertise and how much we're dedicated to SR&ED. Some positive changes that Jason is implementing to the SR&ED program to make it much more easier for companies, or not easier, but much more transparent when it comes to claiming SR&ED. A couple of things I'd like to highlight is they're finally part of the email world. You can finally communicate with them via email. And because of COVID, they've implemented secure video conferencing for any first-time claimant advisory services or audits. They're actually finally using technology. Before 2020, you could only communicate with them via phone or fax. So very archaic technologies. So they are making some changes. And one thing, if you have a question about any of the COVID funding that you've received, like SUS or RRF or IEP, that funding will definitely reduce your claim size. But what we can do is we can certainly look at how to mitigate that impact on your SR&ED claim. So we have some strategies around that. So that's the SR&ED program, high level, very high level. More than happy to answer any questions about that. Grants, should you apply? The answer is yes and no. If I can just instill you with one thing from this, I wouldn't recommend creating a project to go after a certain grant. When it comes to grants, I would recommend aligning the grants with what you're planning to do in the next 6 months, a year, 2 years. Typical lead time when applying for grants can take anywhere from 6 weeks. That's typically for a hiring grant, so smaller type of grants where you're $5,000 to $30,000 kind of thing. And I actually should change this. It's anywhere now, because of COVID, a year to a year and a half for some of the larger grants, especially if we're talking at least $100,000 to millions of dollars. So that 6-month time frame is very arbitrary now. Again, to highlight, grant approval must be obtained before the project hiring or training begins. So remember, you must be granted permission before spending the money. How best to ensure success? So again, this goes back to what I was talking about looking at grants as a way to leverage your initiatives that are already part of your strategy. And what we can do is we can help create a grant canvas to facilitate this. What that is it's just essentially a Gantt chart or timeline of when you're planning to start things or when you're planning to do the hiring and when you should apply for certain grants and things like that. So now we're going to get into grant examples for you, sir, so for you to take away. So I've broken them out into different categories for you. I'm not going to go into detail about every single one because there are a lot, but I'm just going to go over some examples for you. One of the ones that I always love, and so when it comes to working with Leyton with hiring grants, we don't tend to write them for you or get involved. All we do is we let them know, or we let our clients know, or let our prospects know, or let you know about the different hiring grants that are out there, because really it only takes about half an hour to an hour to fill it in yourself. So this is a great one. This is Canada Summer Jobs. It reopens every January. You get 75% of minimum wage, typically about 8 weeks at 35 hours a week is the average. If you're not for profit, you actually get 100% of the wages covered. So that's really good. It's for hiring a summer intern. And just so you know, a lot of these hiring grants, you'll see eligibility typically the same between 15 and 30, typically sometimes a recent grad or a grad in an underpaid job or something like that. But this is good for Canada Summer Jobs. You can apply for as many positions as you want. So this is a good one to keep in mind. It reopens every January. It's closed right now. It closed on January 29th, but this is a great one to apply for, to get some extra help over the summer. So this is a digital tech internship. This is to hire a digital tech intern for 6 to 12 months. This is a full-time position. The benefits is you get up to 50% of the intern's salary to a maximum of $12,000. So that's if you pay them $20,000, they'll give you $10,000. If you pay them $30,000, they'll give you $12,000. So you can pay them whatever you want, but if you go above $24,000, you're going to front the cost for the additional. But it is really worth it. You're still going to get $12,000. And here's some. So no more than 30 years of age, as you see. So there's another similar. And they must be available to work for at least 6 months. And this one, they must be a post-secondary grad. So that's one. So ICTC, Ontario Career Connect, this is another internship, maximum 14,000 per intern or 50% of their wage for a minimum of 3 months. So this one, you don't have to hire them for a minimum of six, but, there's different, again, you'll see them between 15 and 30 here. So, this is out of school and cannot have previously worked for the company that is applying. So there, and I just like to take a pause. When it comes to grants, and I was talking to Craig about this, is that grants, there's no one grant that is alike, essentially. And so there are different criteria for each grant. And a lot of times they don't always tell you all of the criteria on the website. So it's a lot of knowing about the grant or having that connection with the granting body to know the insides of the program and what's available. And what's not available. So this is NRC funding. So this is NRC administers what's called the Youth Employment Program as well as the IRAP program. And we'll talk about IRAP in another section. But this is one, so Craig was asking me about the IRAP program earlier. What I'm seeing as well is that the ITAs of the IRAP program are pushing people more towards the employment grant now to kind of establish rapport. And then next year they can potentially apply for IRAP funding. So, but this one is not as good as other ones. It's 50% of the intern salary to a maximum of 12,000. Typical 15 to 30 post-secondary grad. So again, that's specifically for NRC. Mitacs is a good one if you're looking to hire a PhD or a master's student. Again, you get the, it starts at 50% funding and you get a minimum of $10,000 for a 4-month project. We've actually got a great connection with Mitacs. So if anyone's looking, we're more than happy to do an introduction to them. Training, training grants to train your employees. There's essentially only one in Ontario. There's no real federal training programs. So if you're interested in a specific province, we can certainly look to see what's there. But if you're in Ontario, there's the Canada Ontario Job Grant. Now, it doesn't sound like a training grant, but that's what it is. And you get between 50 up to 83% of training costs to a maximum of $6,000 per trainee. And the training has to happen in Ontario. It can't be specific to a specific machine. It's got to be kind of more general, like accounting or different things like that. But this is great if you want to get right now your employees, if they're less busy. This is a great one to apply for. The turnaround time is about 2 to 3 months, you can get them trained up in different skills and get them some more a better skill set. So this is a great one to apply for. So. The SR&ED program is R&D based, so it's an R&D based tax credit. Now we're going to talk about R&D based grants, which are for future projects. The first one, this is a huge program, okay? I just put this in here just to kind of give you an idea of what a large grant looks like and the eligibility. I'm not trying to scare you away, but essentially, it's a minimum of $10 million ask at 50%. So your total project must cost a minimum of $20 million. And even at that minimum, you might even not get approved. Typically, they're looking for, and this is not just a one-year grant that you're applying for. This is a 4 or 5 year timeline that you would be applying for this grant. And they typically want to see at a minimum of 70 new employees hired during that 4 to 5 month period. Just to give you an idea, Stelco is one of the recipients. So it's more of the larger kind of companies, but if you think that you have a valid project that you want to go after, we're more than happy to have that conversation. But just remember, 20 million is the bare minimum, and I would even recommend that your project be at least 30 million in cost to before applying for this one. The IRAP program. this is probably the second oldest from SR&ED. IRAP's been around for many years. You get between 75 and 50% of costs to a maximum of $10 million. I've never worked with anyone that's received $10 million or the $1 million per year. For the most part nowadays, you can expect, if you're applying for the first time, you can expect between $50,000 and $100,000. And what I'm seeing nowadays is they're being a lot more strict with the criteria. So they're really looking at bleeding edge technology, nanotech, AI, machine learning, autonomous vehicles, things that are buzzwords essentially right now. So before they would fund app development and different things like that, as long as there was some uncertainty, they're being a lot more strict. Now, that being said, it is on a individual ITA basis, the eligibility. So what one ITA says yes to, another ITA might say no to. ITA is the information technology advisor. They're the ones who kind of administer the funds in a specific region for IRAP. But the thing is once you're assigned an ITA, you can't really switch. So once you're like, when you call up the IRAP and they say, oh yeah, okay, we'll send an ITA, or they'll call you, that's your ITA going forward essentially. So the one thing with IRAP is they want to see revenue of at least $100,000 before being eligible now. So it's not so much for startups. It's kind of more for a more established kind of company. FedDev is one that I was telling you guys about, that the zero interest repayable loans. So this is for businesses in Southern Ontario for scaling up and expanding and commercializing new technology. It's called the Regional Innovation Ecosystem. This is for late stage technological development to support new markets and or new industrial applications of the technology. This is the zero interest repayable loan I was talking about. So the repayable contributions anywhere from $500,000 up to $10 million per project, and around 35% of the eligible costs. So there's some criteria here. You have to have a minimum of 5 full-time employees, be located in Southern Ontario. And the eligible costs are labor, expertise, non-capital and capital. So, this is a good one if you need to buy machines or things to scale up and expand some sort of technology or your business itself. But just a warning, FedDev is being a lot, because FedDev is another funding arm of the government that was tasked with distributing COVID funding, the RRRF. They're being a lot more strict with the funds that they're giving out. So we're more than happy to do an introduction to FedDev and work with you should you want to go after this. Grants to expand your company or your product into other countries. So Can Export is an amazing program right now for any company that wants to expand into another country. Now, for example, the US Can Export has broken it out into 4 quadrants, so that if you have sales in 1 quadrant of the US and you want to expand into other states, you might be able to do that. So feel free to talk to us about this. But typical business activities are business travel, participation at trade fairs, market research, adaptation of marketing tools for a new market, legal fees, IP protection, things like that. Just one thing to note, currently business travel and participation at trade fairs in person are not covered because the travel is not recommended, but any virtual trade shows that you want to attend, virtual booths, even Google AdWord campaigns, they'll fund you 75% up to $50,000 of your Google AdWord, but they're willing to give you 75% of your costs to expand into new market, up to $75,000 for all of the listed expenses that I listed, including the Google AdWords. The one thing is that you must have at least $100,000 in sales, total sales. It doesn't have to be specific to a product, but total sales revenue before applying for this. So that's one thing that, because they want you to showcase that there is demand in Canada before expanding to other countries. So, other grant information. I talked about CAP briefly. So CAP is for Ontario producers. It's administered by OMAFRA for Ontario producers. It reopens typically every few months. So we're hoping that because it reopened in December, that they are going to reopen it every few months now, but they don't even know what they're going to do. They don't even know what's happening. So if you are in the agriculture space, feel free to reach out and we can keep you in the loop for that. Now I told you I was going to empower you to do your own search. So in this right here, you'll see this link here. You can do your own search. You can create your own profile. This will, once you create a profile and save it, they will actually update you on new grants that get released that relate to your profile. And what I do for prospects and clients is if they do come across something that they're interested in, a grant that they might be interested in, I ask them to send it to me and I'll give them my 2 cents on the grant and whether or not it's worthwhile. So for most grants, you must be incorporated for at least 2 years. I didn't really touch on that, but for anything that you're asking for outside of a hiring grant, they want to see that you've been incorporated for at least 2 years. You have 2 years of financial statements. Some grants require income. Again, grants, you must be approved before starting the work. And again, most hiring grants can be completed within 30 minutes to an hour. Working together, how can we help you? So, in Ontario and the rest of Canada, we have the SR&ED tax credit. We have grants and we have sales tax recovery. There is another tax credit that I didn't really touch on. It's for a specific market. It's for the video game market, essentially. It's called the Interactive Digital Media Tax Credit. There is one in every province, and the criteria is very different in every province. But for the most part, if you're a video game developer, you would be eligible for this tax credit. And that's something we can talk about. If you're in Quebec, there's also an e-business tax credit that we can help you with. It's to help to support companies specializing in IT sector in Quebec specifically. So with us, I know that after working at other shred firms or shred services, typically they have a financial person and a technical person. So you kind of have two points of contact. It can get confusing at times. Here, we make sure we have one dedicated point of contact for all of your for all your shred needs, one dedicated point of contact for all of your grant needs, and one dedicated point of contact for a sales tax recovery or a property tax recovery. So we're very flexible in how we work with you. We can adjust. So we have clients who want to meet with us on a monthly basis. Some of our larger clients, we have clients that want to meet with us on a quarterly basis, biannual basis. Some just want to touch base once a year. But they do like that we're thinking about them, and we do send them different grants that we can help them with or work on them with. So, We are very customer centric when it comes to working with clients. When it comes to fees, I'll just talk about fees briefly. The most popular option that we offer is contingency, even for grants. So shredding and grants and sales tax and property tax are all success fee based or contingency fee based, and the fee ranges based on the size of the claims. We work in every sector. I myself consider myself more of a blockchain expert. We don't have that up here yet, but we have blockchain, AI, machine learning. That's on the IT side, but we also have manufacturing, software, chemistry, gaming. Essentially, we have an expert for any industry that you might want someone to be an expert in. So we have PhD and master's consultants. We also have engineers and everything across the board to work with you, to understand your technology, to make it very minimally invasive on you, to put together any kind of claim. And that's me. Any questions?
That was great. We have a bunch of questions, and you answered some of them near the end there. So if they want to ask more specific questions, they can repost them. But what is the minimum threshold for the job training grant, and can it be used for one employee?
So for the minimum threshold for the job training grant, I don't as minimum threshold for what, as far as how much you're asking for?
Yes.
I don't believe there's a minimum threshold for how much to ask for. It's more along the lines of it's just a maximum. So you could probably apply for it if you have a training cost of $500. There's no minimum for that.
Great. Yep.
And yes, it can be for one employee. But just so you know, the process might not be worth it for just one employee. Now, what I would suggest you do for the Canada Ontario Job Grant is think about your whole year. What do you want to do over the whole year? You can apply for things that are going to be 6 months or 12 months away. So think about it from that perspective, and you might have more people.
There's another question here about this one. For self-employed people who are incorporated and show themselves as an employee of the company, can they be available for the employee training funds?
I don't believe so, but I can look into it and certainly get back to you. That's a great question. I've never run into that before. I have, to be honest, I've only done a few of these. I do have a grant expert, Ryan Lammers. He's a PhD. He would probably know more, but I haven't done any self-employed with employees. So that's a great question, though. I can certainly get back to you if you want to get in contact with me.
So we have another one here. A third company is new to Canada, but has existed 30 plus years in the UK. Mm-hmm. Can we obtain funding for expansion into Canada?
That's a good question. There are UK/Canada grants. that we might be able to find. I'm not aware of any specific for what you're talking about. The one thing to note is that when it comes to grants that you're applying for, some grant bodies might be okay with the fact that you're just new in Canada, but most are going to want to see that you've been here for at least 2 years, because the government doesn't want to just give a company money to come in, like if they've just come in for a few months and then they're going to leave, take the money and leave kind of thing. So they want to see that you're planning to be established here in Canada for the most part. But for expansion from the UK into Canada, that's certainly something we can look into if you want to reach out. These are great questions.
Yes, definitely. So now we got one specifically on IRAP.
Okay.
Any platform or any app can apply or claim to be working on revolutionary AI tech app / website platform. So let's say you're creating a new Uber of XYZ or whatever, and you will use AI or blockchain or machine language. My question is, who's to say to what degree AI or ML will be integrated into the platform, and how will they be analyzed, your AI or ML integration, in order to determine your eligibility?
Yeah. Great question. So this is one where you can't really pull the wool over their eyes too much, because you have to report every month to them. So, and ITAs, they're very technical as well. So you can present to them what you're planning to do, and you might get a couple months of funding out of them if you aren't integrating AI or ML, but eventually they're going to know and they're going to cut off the funding. What I would recommend, like, there's not really any threshold for what you should be integrating or whatnot. All I'm trying to caution you on is that that's more of their focus. Saying that they're not going to fund an app or something, some sort of platform development that doesn't have AI or ML. I'm saying that for the most part, they're focusing more on bleeding edge kind of tech, if that answers your question.
I think it does.
Yeah.
So we got another question here about what grants are available on provincial or federal for food manufacturers.
Yes. So there are a few, and they are administered by OMAFRA. So if you want to just type in OMAFRA or even Canadian Agricultural Partnership, then you'll get a list there. The reason why I don't have a concrete answer is because what I'm finding lately with Agritech is that they're opening and closing very quickly. So they're coming and going. So I don't know what's currently out there, but there are different streams for producers, processors, and what they call other businesses. So that don't fit into producers or processors. So there's a bunch of different streams out there, and feel free to go to OMAFRA or Canadian Agricultural Partnership. Or reach out to us.
Great. Now a question about the film industry. Film, yes. Streaming, we can be categorized in the culture film e-commerce. Are there any funds that pop to mind that Leyton specialize in? Oh, I didn't know that. P.S. They're incorporated in Quebec, but on a federal level.
Yes. So that's a great question. There are tons of film and tax credits and grants. To be honest and completely transparent, we aren't experts in that, but we are grant experts, and we can certainly help navigate, and we can help you. It's just a matter of, so when it comes to getting involved in a new grant, it's just a matter of reaching out to the granting body for us and establishing a relationship. Typically, it's an application process. And so what we can help do is write most of the content and do that for you. But there are a lot. Ontario Creates is one. There is also the Bell Media Fund. That's another one. There's also the Shaw. Shaw has one as well. So there's a bunch of different ones out there. And there's tons. There's tons for film. There's tons for movies. There's some for books, publications, and things like that. And the arts specifically.
Great. So obviously they're for both Quebec and Ontario, all those ones you mentioned.
So some are federal and some are provincial, and there's specific provincial ones. So there's specific provincial film tax credits. So you'll see at the end of movies, you'll see the Quebec film tax credit or Ontario film tax credit. So those are ones that that are specific, but we can certainly have a conversation and explore maybe how we can help or point you in the right direction at least.
What about the mining industry?
Yes, the mining industry. So one that I didn't really touch on, because mining is more Northern Ontario, in, as far as in my mind, there are grants for Northern Ontario. One of the big ones and easier ones to apply for if you're in Northern Ontario is NOHFC, the Northern Ontario Heritage Fund. It's administered by FedNor, which is a branch of FedDev. There are some mining grants out there, but there aren't very many. And when it comes to SR&ED, it's there are you can apply for SR&ED tax credits. But if you're exploring, if you're just doing exploring or routine mining and things like that, you're not going to be eligible for SR&ED. But if you're doing things that are innovative, then there's potential for that as well.
Yeah, they're specifically prospectors here. So
okay, so if you're just doing prospecting, for the most part, there's not really any grants. It's more these most of the grants and things when it comes to mining and things like that are for innovation and advancing technology. So if you're developing prospecting technology, then yes, we can. There's certainly some availability.
And we've seen a lot of healthcare and specifically mental healthcare startups popping up, especially in COVID. We're all kind of being antisocial, and that affects us in a mental way. What kind of grants are there specifically or for mental healthcare?
I'm sure there are some out there, but I don't know of any, to be honest with you. That would be Health Canada. And I actually tried navigating that website a while ago, and it is a pain. but if it's something that you're interested in, we can certainly have a conversation. I was just doing it personally, but if there's a real reason for me to do it, I'm more than happy to have a look for you as well.
So there's another question about how Leyton charges. You mentioned some of it earlier, but do you charge some fees from clients that it helps, or do you get paid by government for helping the companies?
No, so we get paid by the client. The government does not pay us. We can also, so I did talk about contingency fee base, which is the most popular, but we also can do hourly or flat fee if that's something you want to do. But no, the client would pay us to help you get the money from the government.
Great. Yeah, the feedback here on YouTube was, thanks for the honest feedback about Health Canada. It's truly a pain to try and get through that site.
You know what? And that's how I've always been. I've always been transparent and honest. I'll tell you if I don't know something. I'll tell you straight up my opinion. It's not the most popular opinion sometimes, but I feel I like to do that. I don't like wasting people's time, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I'm the same with you. My saying is, I don't like wasting anybody's time, and most of all my own. if people want to work with you, and a lot of people do, first of all, let me, before we get into that, what didn't I ask about that I should have?
I tried to cover everything. I don't think there's much that you should have asked that you didn't. I think we've covered for the most part everything. Yeah.
There's another question. So there's another question here about rates, and I think you covered it, but you might as well go through it again, because do you charge clients a fixed rate, or is there a percentage of the grant amount? And if so, what percentage?
Yeah, so it's typically a percentage. We can do fixed rate if you like. The percentage fee ranges anywhere from 0.5% if we're going after millions of dollars to 20 to 25% if it's a smaller, depending on the size of the grant or the size of the tax credit.
Thanks for all the questions today. We got a lot of people who want to reach out to you and Leyton. And if they want to get a hold of you or contact Leyton to find out more, how do they do that?
Yeah, sure. So I'm going to type in my email address here, and also my direct line. So feel free to reach out at any time. Send me an email, give me a call. I'm typically super busy, super back-to-back meetings throughout the day. So if you want a response throughout the day, send me an email. But you can also go to our website and have a look, Leyton.com. Or you can contact Craig, and Craig can put you in touch with us as well.
I really appreciate taking the time today and giving us a snapshot of all those different opportunities that people should be going after, and giving you honest feedback on all these questions. Thank you again, and thank everyone for showing up and bearing with us through. Sometimes tax credit information can be dry. I think you've made it very entertaining and informative today without doing that. So that is very appreciated. Thanks again, everyone, and we'll see you all again soon.
Thanks, guys. Thanks so much, Craig. I